welcome to more Orthodoxy, or more Christ, I should say. This is a channel dedicated to Catholics, Orthodox, and Protestants alike. Today I'm joined by Inaya Folarin Iman. She is the founder and director of the Ecuano Project, a debate, discussion, and ideas forum. She is also a writer, a commentator, and a campaigner. Inaya uses her work to explore subjects in politics and philosophy, with a particular interest in freedom of speech and expression, in democracy, liberty, and human potential. Just to begin then, Inaya, perhaps you can share a bit about your work, your website, and the Ecuano Project.
Yeah, so obviously, firstly, thank you for the introduction and thank you for inviting me. The Ecuano Project is a very new organization. And if I thought about it, you know, last year, I probably wouldn't have imagined starting something like this. But I think that the organization is essentially there to kind of champion the liberal tradition of anti-racism, in contrast to what I would regard as the very kind of divisive, identitarian, kind of race-conscious type of thinking that has permeated all of the kind of discourse in relation to race in really the entirety of the kind of Anglosphere in Western society. And I decided to start it a few months ago at the peak of the Black Lives Matter protests, when there was a very definitive and kind of authoritative push from many layers of society and many angles of society to frame Britain in particular as a fundamentally racist society whose history and culture is defined fundamentally by racism, and that the fundamental interaction between people of different categories of race was one of power and essentially racism and subjugation. I thought that was wrong on its assumptions and it was wrong on its facts. And I think very few people, unfortunately, just because of the vociferous nature of the discourse, have been fearful or feeling unable to be able to really challenge it, even if they are instinctively or intuitively and feel that the narrative doesn't necessarily ring true with what their experience of society is. And so I think, as I'd already been involved in freedom of speech campaigning as you described in relation to democracy and liberty, I guess I wanted to use my position to show that there is another way, there is another perspective, and it is also grounded in a material reality and also a positive future-oriented vision of what our society is and can be.
Yeah, wonderful. I just want to ask you a bit about your own background then, to get an idea of how you came to some of these conclusions. Perhaps you could tell us about some of the key events or the key moments in your life that have helped shape the woman that you are now.
Yeah, so I was born in the UK, but I'm a child of Nigerian immigrants to Britain. But I was raised in a single parent household, and I often tell this story because I do think it is quite defining in terms of my political outlook. On paper, I think many people in my family could tick many oppression points, so to speak. But that was never, ever, not even in the slightest, the mentality that I was inculcated with. And I think from my own experience, I think there is incredible power in just the kind of way of thinking that you perceive the world through. And I think a lot of that seems to have been massively eroded. Everything is very much about structures and society, but very few of the narrative is about kind of personal transformation and what we can do as individuals, but with our own families and communities, to actually take responsibility and do what we can regardless of the kind of constraining societal factors that exist. So that was very much what shaped me, seeing, you know, my mother and many of my family members, regardless of difficult personal circumstances, being able to triumph over them and still have a very hopeful and optimistic and strong vision of the world. And so myself, as someone that is very lucky to have been, you know, raised in a society that enjoys many freedoms that we all take for granted, I think it would be very absurd for me to utilize that position and squander it to basically self-sabotage myself or seek to destroy many of the values that many of us take for granted. So I'd say my upbringing definitely shaped my political perspective. And also, I think, you know, university, I'm actually a relatively recent graduate, and I think I'd wanted universities to be a space of challenging intellectual pursuits and the kind of search for higher meaning and truth. But unfortunately, it's an incredibly stifling culture at the moment. And so I think many of these things really made me think, you know, our society should be a bastion for freedom and kind of democracy and liberty, these things that we champion internationally. but we're not necessarily in keeping with them at home.
Excellent. Couldn't agree more. So you mentioned your mother and the influence that she had. Was there anybody else who has been especially inspirational or influential for you, rather in your personal life, or anybody in academia or anything like that?
Yeah, a few people. I guess I'm generally not the kind of person to idealize people in particular, but I genuinely do admire anyone really that is principled, one, and is able to put their head above the parapet. So I've always been admiring of figures, you know, historically and also presently from various different sides of the political spectrum. The obvious examples are actually, interestingly, Martin Luther King, but also Malcolm X, despite the fact that many of his kind of black radical or kind of black nationalist political philosophy doesn't necessarily align with mine. I still admire the ability for individuals to really stand up for what they believe in, and so that's been very influential to me. But I guess in my personal life, I was very lucky again early on in my adulthood to be around people that saw actual spirituality, not necessarily religion, but spirituality as a very fundamental aspect of their life, and sought to facilitate conversations about and cultivate thinking which saw us as beyond just kind of material bodies on this very short earth, but actually beings of potential infinite possibility. So I think throughout my life I've been surrounded by very strong people in their thinking and in their being, which has inspired me to hopefully cultivate very similar qualities.
Yeah, excellent. So whenever I saw your more kind of autobiographical videos on YouTube, you mentioned that sort of spiritual type, so I was kind of interested in that. It reminded me of people like Jung and Jordan Peterson and how they are offering a more comprehensive and interesting view of the world. And it suggests a lot of the kind of even new atheists and people like that, perhaps. So that's really interesting. I also wanted to ask you about your kind of background as a Nigerian British woman. Do you have any Christian or Muslim more religious figures that you've been brought up around, and has that affected you in any way?
I'd say that it's quite funny because religiously my family are quite diverse, so many people in my family are in Nigeria were actually followers of Islam, and then many of them are Christian and many of them converted to Christianity. And for a short while my mom was a Christian, but then she left the faith, which you might regard as unfortunate for them. But I think that I would say, I guess Martin Luther King is very powerful in relation to that tradition. And I think what I really, really like about the kind of Christian humanist tradition, it is both, you know, a kind of rootedness in the kind of transcendental elements of our existence, that there is, you know, something beyond that we all should be able to be under it, essentially. We are all kind of under this one, you know, God. And I think that that's incredibly powerful. And I think that that transcends any kind of parochial, racial, sexual, or kind of gender identities. And we are all kind of accountable to that concept of God. So I think that's very powerful, but also recognizes the power of human beings. Mm-hmm. And that whilst we are on this planet, you know, we don't know what's after, but you know, whilst we are here and we have agency and we are able to, within our lives individually and collectively, create a much better world that inspires people to be the best that they can, and that is possible. So I think obviously the fact that, you know, Britain, despite the fact that it's not necessarily as religious overtly as it was before, I think Christianity does play a massive impact in relation to our traditions. This whole idea of, you know, turning the other cheek, thou without sin shall cast the first stone. I think these are very beautiful and profound concepts that actually should resonate with all people, regardless of your if you have a faith and none. So I do think, even if I didn't have religious figures as such influence me, I think that religious principles have definitely shaped my thinking.
Yeah, excellent. So in light then of your excellent recent essays on things like abolition race, I'd like to ask you, what does that mean in theory and practice then? So you touched upon this more universal vision there and Christian humanism. I'd like to just ask you a bit about that.
Yeah, so I think It's really interesting. So I guess I'll first give a little description about how I came to think about this idea of transcending race. And as we've already talked about, you know, generally speaking, I identify largely as British. You know, I don't actually have Nigerian nationality. I wasn't born there. I don't speak the language, but I still recognize that that tradition within my heritage. So generally I say I'm British Nigerian. But I think that's how I'd always kind of identified. And then as I got older, the concept of kind of blackness started to shape the discourse around minority identity more profoundly. And I actually often found that the concept of blackness was problematic for several reasons. One, I think it actually erased the huge diversity and complexity of African diasporic populations, whether that is from the Caribbean to West Africa to Somalia to South Africa. These are not homogenous groups. They have different relationships with Britain. They have different migratory patterns, cultural habits. And this term black just completely erased all of that. And then on top of that, oftentimes, you know, blackness isn't just the color of your skin, even though it's not actually the skin color one has, but it's often also came with a prescribed set of characteristics. Oftentimes it meant, you know, you're meant to think a certain way, enjoy certain kinds of music. So it often came with a stereotype. And also, finally, blackness is only understood in relation to whiteness. So it's often this kind of category that's framed in a kind of adversarial relationship with you know, white people. And I think that's problematic for so many reasons. So that's how I started to question it. But as I actually researched, what was really fascinating to me, and I think this isn't really talked about as much in the race conversation, the concept of race as specific distinct races is actually a relatively new concept, and there's always been peoples, you know, from different parts of the geographical population regions, but this idea of a kind of pure race that is defined and immutable is only a few hundred years old. Mm-hmm. And we've come to have our entire social relations nearly shaped by this concept, which I think is very divisive. You know, in America, something like the average African American actually has something up to like a third European DNA, and interestingly similar with white Americans. So I think that for me, transcending race, so that's the kind of theory behind it. But transcending race is to me, one, recognizing or having a kind of realization that this concept that defines so much of our society is neither immutable nor perennial. It is actually very recent, it is invented, and it does a lot of damage. And I don't think that, I think that when we continue to affirm its meaning and importance, whether positive or negative, we are further giving this concept weight and credence, something that has done so much damage to our common humanity. And so transcending it is one, realizing that, and consistently arguing against any attempt to instill race with meaning, and going beyond this category, potentially seeing possibilities of human social relations as us, as just human beings, as individuals that might look different, that might have different heritages and origins, but there is no point in this very rigid category, in my view.
Excellent. Yeah. So even from an Irish perspective, we were brought up with, a lot of us anyway, we're brought up with this same adversarial notion of this dichotomy between the oppressor and the oppressed or whatever. And only in Ireland, it wouldn't be along skin colour lines. It would be along kind of ethnic religious lines or nationalist and unionist and stuff like that. So I've seen the damage it can do in Northern Ireland, unfortunately, and couldn't agree with you more, especially when you look to the history, like the ideas of whiteness didn't include, say, the Irish for the longest time and Jewish people and stuff like that. And now, so if, say, I leave the island of Ireland or even within Ireland now with the global media, you're considered primarily white rather than, say, Irish, or more importantly for me, would be Christian, and the even more humanist terms like you're suggesting. So thanks for that, Inaya.
I find it is crazy, you know, very recently, as you mentioned, Irish people, Spaniards, Italians weren't actually considered white, that they were considered, you know, near white or something other than white. And, you know, white people was a very narrow conception of kind of Anglo-Saxon or Nordic or Nordic in particular. And I think, what we could now regard in the last 30 years to be a completely self-evident category has had fundamentally different meanings throughout history.
Excellent. So just more specifically then, because it's so much in the news and because they seem to dominate the narrative so much, what is some of your main critiques of Black Lives Matter, whether that be the organization as it's laid out with their kind of Marxist principles, or whether that be the broader movement and the hashtag?
I guess I have several critiques. I think there's so much to critique, it's difficult sometimes to know where to start. I think, so what I alluded to earlier, again, I think that they're wrong on their assumptions and they're wrong on their facts. So they're wrong on their assumptions, which is that Britain is both racist, there's never been any progress, you know, racism has just taken different forms, essentially, and that we can't necessarily go beyond this moment. All we can do is manage relations between different skin colors. That's essentially what their assumption is. I think that is wrong. I think that any movement that doesn't recognize the progress that we've made over the last 100 years cannot be taken seriously. You know, we're really in a situation, I mean, even in America, you know, obviously the focus is Britain here, but in America, you know, they had institutionalized segregation. People were literally barred from actually entering certain spaces. There were different fountains for different races. To suggest that racism essentially is just the same, but it's just, you know, now it's kind of unconscious bias, I find to be a massive insult, a huge slap in the face for the work that's been done. But in Britain, again, yeah, very few ethnic minority people would describe racism to be an everyday aspect of their life. Actually, in Britain, more black, Jamaican black men in London, they're more likely to actually marry a white woman than they are actually to a black woman. So we're talking about huge barriers to intercultural or interracial interracial relationships completely dissolving. So there has been huge progress made. So I think that they're really wrong on this narrative about, you know, essentially everything is just similar, but it's become unconscious. Unconscious bias, this ridiculous, ideology that's seeping into so much of the workplace and education. I also think this whole notion of critical race theory, which actually is very influential in the thinking of kind of the intersectional theorists and all of these people, that in the words of Helen Pluckrow, she says, what they regard as, it's not, the question isn't did racism happen, is how did racism manifest itself. And I find that very interesting. So I was in an interview and they literally said racism is like the air, it permeates every level of our society. That is just ridiculous. That is just not true. That is not what most people believe or most people experience. And you can see it's completely ideological. And then the other thing, they're wrong on their facts. Okay, you know, when we look at the data and statistics in the UK in particular, for example, black African young people have a far higher educational attainment than the wider population at large, and it's different for black Caribbean. So there's actually huge disparity within ethnic groups. Some of the research coming out now is that for people are out in their 20s, there is no income disparity. So there's a lot of really interesting data coming out showing that actually there's actually very little, if not no, disparity in some elements of society at all. And then the two wealthiest ethnic groups in Britain are not white British, it's Indian households and British Chinese households. So we're talking about a whole conversation that is almost completely divorced from reality. I think class, regardless of ethnic group, is the biggest determiner of life outcomes. It is not your race.
Excellent. I'm curious about, so you mentioned Helen Pluckrow and people like that. You've obviously James Lindsay, more atheistic people. What are the prospects, do you think, between more liberal-minded non-Christians and Christians coming together to combat the kind of crude narrative of the new left? Do you think there's any pitfalls and opportunities that you see as particularly important or interesting?
I think that, I think that's a good question. Mm-hmm. I think that we all have to go back to kind of our foundational principles. I think we all have to go, okay, what do we share? Yeah, what values and principles do we all share? And I think that very quickly we will find that, you know, whether you're Christian or Muslim or Jewish, we'll find that at the level of principle, we actually pretty much all share very, very similar principles if we're talking about the liberal tradition. And then we have to then ask ourselves, well, how do we best realize those principles? How do we best enable those principles to shine most within our society? Now, I think that from a religious perspective, you know, someone might say, you know, obviously follow God and follow the traditions of the religion. But I think from a societal perspective, if we accept the diversity of belief within society, I think that we can all come to some broad agreement in terms of what needs to be done. And so even if you may say, oh, that, you know, in a Christian tradition, you need to kind of live a good life, I would say that also, you know, but I wouldn't necessarily say it from a religious perspective. And I think actually what you would regard as a good life might be very similar to what I would regard as a good life, you know, taking responsibility for yourself, you know, being kind, working hard, respecting the law, respecting each other. And I think that when we talk about these things at the level of principle, I find that we will actually have a lot more in common than we do differ. And I think we can all agree that many of these challenges that we're seeing ideologically counter almost all of those principles, whether that is not obeying the law. You know, we're seeing a collapse of law and order in some areas of America. You know, that's counter to the principles that both Christians and just people that follow a liberal tradition would share, whether that is, you know, treating each other with kindness and respect. Even the Christian belief that there is a spark of divinity within all human beings, I actually believe that too. You know, I believe that there is unbounding potential in all human beings. So I think that the model, in terms of, you know, taking it from a principle perspective rather than a ideological or religious one, we'll find that there is a huge overlap between the various traditions that are seeking to counter this particular narrative that we're seeing.
Yeah, excellent. Thank you. And I think that's why maybe Jordan Peterson was so interested and so influential for so many people, because he obviously focused on the logos and the kind of mythos that's underneath the civilization and talked about that as a common inheritance. And that obviously was down in part to the ancient Greeks as well as the Christian tradition. I guess we can share logic, obviously. So you mentioned this idea of racism being everywhere. There's a secular guy called Jonathan Church who's written some excellent essays about the logical fallacies within the idea of whiteness and stuff like that, which is really good. It calls it a fallacy of reification, I think. And then we've also got, I guess, from my perspective, I'd be pretty libertarian. So it's a liberal too in a lot of cases, I suspect. Notion of the zero aggression or non-aggression principle, so that's obviously meant to be manifested socially and so on. So I do hope there is some long-term commonalities between us. So regarding that more humanistic perspective, then I see some of these people like Frederick Douglass, Booker T. Washington, Dr. King, who you mentioned. Are there any others aside from Dr. King that you've really researched and you find really important for Christians, liberals, and the Western tradition?
Well, people that personally that I've actually been influenced a lot by, I've actually been influenced quite hugely by kind of more existentialist philosophers, and I think that that's some of the thinking that has shaped my thinking. So, you know, Sartre, Camus, and also actually not necessarily an existentialist philosopher, but also Nietzsche. And I think any thinking that I think centers the capacity of the individual to be able to take ownership of their life, define their own destiny, and exercise their own agency and shape the world around them as kind of meaning makers. For me, I'm very drawn to any philosopher or philosophy that champions that particular perspective. I think it is incredibly powerful, and not just powerful, I think it rings true. I think that there is almost a universal truth about how you end up shaping the world around you. I don't think it's just a cliche. Many of these kind of ideas that you alluded to, Jordan Peterson, I don't think that they've become so powerful and influential to many of the kind of generation with Jordan Peterson, because they're just things that we like to hear. I think that they do speak to a very universal truth. So yeah, existentialist philosophers have very much influenced my thinking. I think that they can be important in the views of people, yeah, regardless of what tradition necessarily you are come from. And I think that is, again, one of the reasons why I'm so instinctively hostile to, or instinctively reluctant to adopt or accept many of the premises that are being pushed by identitarian activists at the moment. This idea of kind of racial determinism, this notion that, you know, whether you're white, you're destined to be privileged, or white fragility, all of these things, or if you're black, you know, you're destined to be victimized or oppressed, and you need, you know, another ethnic group or race of people to recognize you in order for you to succeed in life. This is such disempowering stuff. This is such demoralizing stuff. How can anyone feel that they can take control of their life and express their boundless potential when the entire societal narrative is that the color of your skin is essentially like a prison that you cannot escape from? And so, yeah, any ideas that center the transformational capacities of each human being is something that I recommend and support.
Excellent. Thank you, Inaya. So what do you think about the 1619 project in the US and this broader attempt to rewrite history? I don't know whether there's British equivalents yet, but I'm sure it's coming. What do you think about that?
I think it's an awful thing. I think it is part of a counter enlightenment movement that has emerged, seeking to essentially rewrite the story of Western civilization in order to undermine the things that we hold dear. Obviously, the 1619 is trying to claim that, you know, America was founded when the first slave arrived, I think it was. Mm-hmm. And I think that is, again, not true. And I think it's incredibly dangerous. I think they want to reverse and essentially dissolve the ideal of America, which is, you know, the land of liberty and hope and prosperity, that anyone, regardless of who you are, rich or poor, can make it. And that regardless of the fact that it, obviously America was founded on that contradiction of such, you know, powerful ideals, but the reality of kind of racism, I think that it is, you know, that project is not complete, that enlightenment project of America, and that must continue, and any attempt to undermine that should be forthrightly pushed back against. And I think it's I think it's a counter-enlightenment movement and with very dark and pernicious intentions. And I think we see similar things in Britain with the kind of decolonize the curriculum, you know, why is my curriculum white, all this kind of movement to try and say anything good and valuable, any achievement of Western civilization is essentially a product of racism and hate, and it's an attempt to dismantle all of those things. I think it really demonstrates to me the level of deep psychological destruction that operates under this movement to try and actually attempt to rewrite our own conception of self as a society through the rewriting of history. I think that's very dangerous. I really, really do.
Yeah, unfortunately, I agree. What do you think of then Dr. King and others like that being made into figures centered on this Black history rather than a more inclusive or humanist history? And the attempt, it seems, to idolize his Blackness, whatever the hell that's meant to mean, while ignoring his actual beliefs and his character. Obviously, he has that famous quote about the content of your character, not the color of your skin, but yet people are doing the exact opposite. How much of a problem do you think that is? And do you see that manifest in itself? Because from my perspective, I see it in schools, even the way that history is taught, like Black history is taught, as a kind of ritual to be repeated. Coleman Hughes talks about that. Do you have any thoughts about that?
Yeah, I think I guess people is a product essentially of the time we're living in, you know. Yeah. People are not defined by the content of their character or the words that they utter and the contributions that they've made to the, you know, human history. They're defined by their race. I mean, you know, in Britain we've had this whole idea of removing dead white men or whatever it is from the canon. So whether that's Shakespeare or, you know, John Stuart Mill or any influential thinker, British thinker that has shaped our society, you know, they're even trying to define them by their race. And so I think it's just an unfortunate inevitable consequence of the kind of hyper-racialized thinking, and I think it's attempt again to kind of limit the scope and impact of King's contributions by basically keeping him in this framework as a kind of just a black thinker or a black activist or something like that. I think that's very silly. I think, you know, with regards to black history, again, I understand the reason why it was originally created. Obviously, as there was a genuine and real sense that the contribution of people of African heritage or the African diaspora was being actively excluded from what was being conceived of, as what created the nation or shaped it. But again, I think if we are, at some point, we're going to have to move beyond that. We can't just say, oh, because of this historical moment, this has to be the thing that we do forever. Progress to me is this, what I've been talking about, this humanist universalist perspective, where all of these people are seen within the kind of canon of contributors to humanity, and we recognize the important contributions various people have made throughout history for their contributions. And so even if it was created for a specific purpose to recognize people that were being undervalued, it doesn't have to be that way. And actually progress would be integrating it into a wider national story, not just a race-based history or a race-based narrative of Britain.
Yeah, I think it seems to me that the idea of post-colonialism, as in centering everything around, say, European colonialism, and even then it's only certain European countries and obviously certain people within those countries that were really actively involved in it, but it seems to be, like, from a Christian perspective, the way we view Christ and the life, death and resurrection as the center of history and as something that should be repeated, it's now been sort of transposed to the secular version. And I think what you said is exactly the right anecdote, so that you are antidote to say, yeah. So you actually do tell it as one long linear story and not this repetitive myth, the same point Coleman makes. But yet this seems to be very particular too, because any actual modern colonialism is ignored or cast off as maybe even a byproduct of Western colonialism, so-called. So the evils that are perpetrated by people in China and Turkey and places like that are all ignored. And the sort of dogma is that we should just blame America for all the troubles in the Middle East or whatever. I was wondering what you think about that kind of sleight of hand in particular.
Yeah, I think a lot of these people don't actually realize that they are perpetuating the very same thing that they are arguing to fight against. They center Europe and white people in everything in the world, you know, that no one can ever be responsible for their actions. No one can ever meaningfully change their society or improve their life unless, you know, Europe or white people do a very specific thing for them. And again, you know, that is a form of Eurocentrism. And it's very bizarre that they don't see that. And I think, I think it is a very, very much a sleight of hand to, again, continue and perpetuate this same narrative that enables them to be able to make excuses for any kind of horrific or terrible or bad behavior. And as you described, there's atrocities going on right now, and I don't say this in a flippant way, I say in a really, really, you know, deep and devastating way, that there are people that are literally enslaved or being subjugated based off of, you know, what they look like. And again, this gets completely obscured as we fixate on, you know, the most minutiae debates about, you know, race in our societies. And I think, again, it's an attempt to be able to deflect away from the genuine, meaningful, harsh realities of what life is like in many other different countries. And I think it's very negative. And I think one of those things is actually why the establishment or the kind of political elite are so fond of Black Lives Matter. I think it's very telling how they've lapped it up essentially, because I think that this particular idea, this particular ideology enables them to exert moral superiority over the general population, but also to actually deflect attention from the realities of various kind of horrific practices that are going on. I mean, one of the things that happened recently is Ben and Jerry's was talking about, had the audacity to talk about, you know, we need to, you know, take in migrants from the Channel or whatever. What I was saying was that one of the things that has been really interesting has been the way in which the establishment in particular has been so welcoming of the Black Lives Matter movement and the kind of identity politics narrative, where a lot of us kind of frame these movements as radical, and that they are radical insofar as they seek quite fundamental change of our society, but they're not radical insofar as they actually fundamentally threaten the kind of structures that are rigid within our society, or yeah, they wouldn't have adopted them or taken them up so easily. And I think one of the ways, the reasons why the media, the cultural and political establishment have been so vociferous in their campaigning and championing of this kind of identitarian narrative has been because I think it actually suits the structures and power structures within our society to have a movement that deflects attention away from any kind of meaningful, significant change and focuses on many superficial things, you know, like gesture politics and, you know, putting a saying Black Power and Black Lives Matter, which doesn't actually do anything. Yeah. And on top of that, I think it prevents real solidarity between people. If you say that, if you divide people by race and say that they're essentially in a kind of competition for resources, then that is not a very transformational vision for, you know, being able to unify in order to forge a better society or create a better vision for society that could challenge structures that are actually dividing people. And again, you know, there's slavery, there's extreme deprivation and exploitation going on, and many of these companies are engaging in that, but all they have to do is put forward diversity training. Yeah. And that means that they get great points. So yeah. I think there are many forces that have a vested interest in perpetuating this very divisive narrative about different races.
Excellent. Yeah, I think of Nike in particular. Didn't they have like slave labor in China? And meanwhile, they're propping up the whole Black Lives Matter movement. And there's no sense of, oh, we're hypocrites or anything else. I don't think those contradictions really matter too much to people, unfortunately.
It's funny, but it's also just incredibly sad, because I think that we're in a really unique period in history, you know, whether that is the kind of technological advancements. We have unbelievable ways to communicate with one another that is completely unique. We have huge, you know, economic advancement, as well as many other things that give our generation, this people that are alive in this moment and time, the opportunity to create a much more transformational politics. And unfortunately, you know, we're stuck in this cul-de-sac of thinking, which isn't getting us anywhere. And so I hope that we soon realize what we're doing.
Excellent. Just back to your point there about that they're not really radical. So from a libertarian perspective, the main problem would be the police, for more generally, as having a monopoly of violence within society. And a lot of libertarians would want to abolish the police, but it wouldn't be to have kind of vigilante gangs take their place or whatever. So a lot of libertarians have a plan like to look to the future and how they would do that, private security companies and so on. And I think that speaks to the fact that these people aren't nearly radical enough. And they're not far-sighted enough too, unfortunately, in a lot of cases, because as you said, there's like a moral failure there. If you were to say take the police out of African-American communities in the States. What damage would that do? I think that was a key part of Kim Klatchik's new advertisement about Baltimore, and how the people there were genuinely worried, frightened for their safety, and they had a number of children killed and so on in Baltimore, and the damage that just abolishing the police sort of willy-nilly would do. So
exactly, you know, I do think, you know, there are elements that, you know, the Black Lives Matter and the kind of identitarian activism that is kind of radical insofar as it's very damaging, but I don't, in other areas it doesn't go, as you just alluded to, far enough, you know, where we don't hear about the concept of freedom, you know, whether that's economic or individual freedom. There's actually no coherent, meaningful plan to actually economically develop any ethnic group, let alone African Americans or just or Black Britons. How does defunding the police do anything to the grotesque and disproportionate levels of violent crime? You know, how does that actually, what's the relationship between those things? Or the fact that, you know, as other people have spoken about, African-American kids have a disproportionately low literacy and numeracy rate. How does defunding the police have anything to do with that? And so, yeah, in many ways, it doesn't go far enough because it doesn't meaningfully look in the face the real problems that people are actually facing. And so that's why it's so unfortunate. Any movement or any social justice or social movement that relies on one, censorship and curtailing the freedom of expression of others, which relies on dividing people by race and very simplistic narratives, again, for me, is not one that can be taken seriously. I'll be, even if I disagree with the methods, if there was a meaningful, coherent plan that can be debated about economic development, you know, real economic development of these communities, cultivating cultural and moral values that are prioritize and value entrepreneurship, a strong family unit, responsibility, you know, discipline and education, then we can talk about that, because these are things that we know help people to succeed in life. But there's nothing on individual personal values that can actually transform people's lives. There's nothing that actually meaningfully improves the economic development of communities, or even the just freedom of individual or collective freedom of wider society at large. Is again very most of the things don't begin to get to the root of the issues that we are all facing regardless of race.
Excellent. I think a part of the appeal, obviously, since it's not a logical thing, is a moral argument. So there's an assumed moral superiority to a lot of people that would be defined leftist, for lack of a better word. And yet I would like say that it's morally repugnant, the fact that, so they will lie about the statistics, so say the police brutality in the States, which seems to show that Native Americans are like in relation to the population are twice as likely as African Americans to be unduly accosted and things like that. And then the percentage points between Caucasian Americans and African Americans is very small, even when you do take into consideration the difference between the population, or whenever you relativize it to the population sizes and so on. But they're willing to lie about that in order to make a point about their chosen avatar group member or whatever, and yet they would never report whenever police brutality is done to, say, a white American or a Native American or things like that, which is morally just repugnant as far as I can see. And I don't know, but they obviously get away with it because of the control of the narrative, I guess.
Yeah, exactly. And I think it's all part of this intersectional hierarchy where, you know, different identities are in different places at the hierarchy. So essentially, if you are a Black woman, you know, you are regarding to them, you know, more authentic, more authoritative, you know, more morally superior than someone of perhaps a white male identity. This is their obviously very warped and negative and bizarre thinking. And so that actually ends up playing out in reality. When an atrocity happens, like there was a horrific one called Daniel Shaver, a white man was brutally shot by police in a horrific way. And I don't think the police was ever convicted of anything. That doesn't even get a peep in the media because it doesn't fit this narrative. And so when we're really at a point where we are essentially grading different lives on their value on how much we can take it seriously. We're in incredibly dark waters. And this is the unfortunate thing. I think, you know, no one, when people appropriate the language of righteousness and justice, many people, again, who doesn't want to be seen as the moral person on the right side of history, you know, so people will veer towards those that are speaking all of these, you know, flowery, lovely language and not really interrogating the substance of it, unfortunately. But actually, this is a lot of the time that what tyrants do, they will appropriate the language that, you know, makes people feel good. But when it comes to the actual acts itself, they're deeply damaging. And when we are accepting or giving a platform to any ideologue, and that is as painting a very certain picture of society, we have a responsibility to ourselves to make sure that we deeply, deeply interrogate them on the things that they are calling for. And there's not been anywhere near enough of that in relation to this movement.
Yeah, wonderful. Thank you, Inaya. So I think that touches upon the so-called trans issues and trans activism. I was wondering about your thoughts on that. I haven't really seen too much about this issue specifically from you, because from my perspective, speaking to what we were going on about earlier, from, say, a Christian perspective or a natural rights even perspective, you have pre-political rights, say, for the mother and the child, man, woman, and so on. But in order to have those pre-political rights, you have to be able to define what a man and what a woman is in the first place. So the new trans activists that are attacking people like J.K. Rowling want to abolish the idea of sex at all, and pretend that a biological male is a woman and so on. And do you worry about that from a more liberal perspective? And how do you fear that might play out?
Yeah, I think, you know, this is the way that this is a kind of very hyper-liberal or neoliberal worldview, I think, what we're seeing with the trans activism and even the identity politics, this kind of the erosion of any, you know, community or any kind of even material reality, you know, that's not what you know I conceive of as a progress. Progress is ensuring that we secure people's individual and collective freedom, but that does not mean that we deny reality. And I think everything must be grounded in reality, because we share reality with each other. And so therefore, in order to communicate and engage with one another, we need to be able to have a shared understanding of what is, you know, right and wrong, what is fact and truth, and be able to pursue that in a rational and objective and scientific way. And so this I see the trans activism is again very much on the same trajectory as kind of Extinction Rebellion, you know, this hyper environmentalist worldview, this hyper racial worldview that again divorces one, progress, divorces, you know, objective reality, and divorces any ability to have a kind of rational conversation. Everything's very hyperbolic, everything's very intense and kind of catastrophizing. And so the trans activism, I think that it's again a very negative manifestation. I think most people are very reasonable. Many people think, oh, you know, if you want to wear a certain thing, if you want to change your name and call yourself, and that might make you feel more comfortable, you know, you are within your rights to do that. But that's a very different thing with demanding society, you know, change its definitions of widely accepted and understood concepts to suit your own personal situation or difficulty. And so I think unfortunately, you know, it's causing a massive division and backlash, and I don't agree with that. I think people should wear what they want, they can call themselves what they want, and express themselves what they want. But that's very different to compelling other people to say what not only they don't believe to be true, but what is actually, you know, factually incorrect about, you know, the way that you say you are. And so I think it's a negotiation. I think we have to negotiate with each other in terms of, you know, progress and change and development. I don't think any group of people can just demand it just by virtue of, you know, saying that they have a grievance, regardless of what issue that is. Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that's good. I think my main fear is the fact that obviously whenever you accept this worldview that might is right and it's all about power and so on, the most powerful player is going to be the state. And the state is going to get to define the terms. So obviously, as a Christian, I believe that male and female, they've been created by God, and they are actually different. You know what I mean? And this notion that you can abolish the definition of a woman and have it arbitrarily fall to the state because it's the most powerful player to define a reality, as it were. And I see that as the logic of the trans activist movement, as it were, because what else can you do if you accept the underlying premises that they have, only go and let the state, the largest player, define the terms, and then you don't have children's rights. How can you fight for children's rights if you can't define what a child is? I think this is even coming into the mainstream now quicker than I anticipated, because you see with Netflix trying to sexualize young children. I don't know if you saw the cuties thing that everybody was in uproar about, that they were like 11, and it's being sold, as you said before, by this rhetoric of becoming emancipated from your family and so on, trying to abolish the notion of childhood and more traditional roles. But that's one of my main concerns. I don't know what to think about that.
I would say that this is what the logical consequence of eroding boundaries, eroding reality, means that you are leaving the space for people that have more either opportunist or even quite sinister intentions to be able to mold it in the way that suits them. And if they are passionate, if they are vociferous, if they are loud, if they are powerful, then they're able to dominate the space to which that conversation happens. And that's what we are seeing, because of the kind of level of activism that is so extreme, very hostile. Many women are being tarnished and destroyed reputationally for just criticizing it, when we saw Black Lives Matter. Then oftentimes many people retreat, and then the space to which gets left to kind of shape the conversation is defined by people that often have the most kind of extremist view. So I think that I agree with many of the things that you said in regards to the kind of consequence of this disillusionment of the boundaries, and this kind of idea that there's no objective truth of reality, ends up, as you've just alluded to, dissolving the boundaries between man and woman, adulthood and children. And I think that is a concoction that is very dangerous. I think there's a reason why we have those boundaries, and they have served a very important function within our society for a very, very long time. And I believe there's male and female. I think that is correct, and I think that they are different, and I think male and female work in dynamic motion. I think that that's a very beautiful and positive relationship that is replicated almost everywhere within nature, and that enables the propagation of our species. And so I do think it's dangerous when we enable any kind of ideology that sees everything through the lens of power, that challenges the notion of objective truth, and categorizes people in a way to kind of create an adversarial relationship. And that's a recipe for much of the destruction we're seeing right now.
Mm-hmm. So obviously I'm trying to be hopeful, and I'm learning a lot from obviously yourself and people like Lindsay and Helen Pluckrose and stuff. But from a Christian perspective, my great concern is whether, according to the premises of materialist humanism, that there can be a universal vision in the long term that goes beyond utilitarianism. One counter argument might be that such a moral bind is arbitrary and maybe unsustainable according to those assumptions of philosophical naturalism, because the idea of the universe that you have and how things have developed through Darwinian evolution, that you can't have it. So people like Dawkins and the Selfishine will talk about how they do believe in individual kind of freedom and so on, but they recognize that according to their own premises that it is an illusion, but they want to live it, so they sort of have to go along with it, if you know what I mean. So I don't know, that's my skepticism. I tried to talk to this about, like, a lot of my friends are secularists, so I try to understand and come to some common agreement that we can. So we do have things like human rights and stuff, but I don't know whether you need the underlying Judeo-Christian mythos, as Peterson talks about, in order to maintain that in the long term. So you talk about Nietzsche In some ways, I respect Nietzsche because I think he is very consistent. Because if you do accept some of those ideas, then it seems to me that you do have to go for some sort of an Ubermensch. So we said about the state. I don't see how you can offer a kind of liberal humanism as something beyond merely utilitarian, if that makes sense. And then my friend too, he's transhumanist. So I think transhumanism is the next stage of liberal humanism. But I don't know, I'd love to hear what some of your thoughts about that or any pushback.
A few things. I will say I don't necessarily agree that we need a kind of overarching kind of religious narrative in order to kind of move beyond this moment. I definitely think that there is a relationship between the kind of collapse of religion as a kind of authoritative force within society in relation to the kind of the almost new religions that we are seeing, where, you know, your identity, your race essentially functions as, you know, the underlying shaper of every aspect of your being. And that, you know, even the whole kind of woke narrative, many people like John McWhorter have talked about it functioning very similarly to religion. And I do think that the relationship, there is a strong relationship between the collapse of moral authority from religion and the kind of reemergence of these kind of hyper certain all-encompassing narratives. So I think, because we've seen this emergence, doesn't necessarily, I think, mean that religion is the response to them. So I do think that we are at a point where it is unlikely that we will come to a society that is religious in any kind of way that it was before. But I definitely do believe that there is a kind of like Ubermensch narrative or that type of thinking that can move us beyond a kind of transcendental vision of what humanity can be. There is no vision right now or dominantly about, you know, the power of not just a hyper-individualism that kind of often like Jordan Peterson talks about, but a kind of form of collective organization which is greater than the sum of its parts, that in some ways that is what politics is meant to be, the kind of the mechanism to which we kind of shape society, solve the issues that we have and create a new way of organizing society. And I think that is something that people deeply can believe in and deeply can get behind. And I do think that this isn't just an ideal, but we've seen that in regards to very much the Enlightenment and the way in which the project of the Enlightenment, although some of it was grounded in some Christian ideals, but many of them were kind of talking about a universalist vision, and it was that kind of liberal project that actually helped to transform and change the way that society was from that period of divine right monarchy and so on. So I do have a very deep belief in the capacity of us as human beings to be able to kind of create something greater. And I think that history and the story of history demonstrates that powerful and potential. But I think, again, there's many different stages to do that. I think one, again, we have to kind of completely deconstruct all of this horrific identitarian, you know, all of authoritarianism that we are seeing and start believing in ourselves and our capacity. I'm not a transhumanist. I think transhumanism, I'm not really sure, it doesn't really ring true to me. This kind of, I think that we've barely scratched the surface of our own being, let alone potentially integrating ourselves with technology. I actually think, I think that we've barely been able to really meaningfully recognize the power of our own agency yet to even be able to think of a transhumanist vision. I think that's very, I think it's, personally, I think it's a distraction from the specificities of the problems that we have in the present day. Yeah. And so, yeah, I do actually believe that, because I think many of the most impactful, you know, thinkers, you know, right now, you mentioned the kind of new atheist movement, but even as you talked about some of these emergent thinkers in relation to the debate about race and woke politics, many of them don't necessarily talk from a religious perspective. I think, I believe in human beings a lot. And I think, you know, there's good and evil in all of us, but I think that the change over historical time has ultimately come from us realizing our own potential and exercising it. So I'd have to veer towards a more Nietzschean perspective on that one.
I do hope there's some sort of a long-term common ground. I'm still skeptical, unfortunately, because I just say, like, whenever you say that, I just wonder, like, why one vision over another? You know, I don't see how it can bind universally and be actually meaningful. I think you need revelation from outside, God outside of the system, as it were, to actually make it binding and authoritative. Whereas, so that would be like Christianity, Judeo-Christianity, or Islam, or something. For me, from my perspective, that would make more sense. But I do appreciate absolutely what you're saying, and I do hope that there is some common ground and so on. But I think maybe part of the problem has been with people like Pinker, for example, who take the parts of the so-called Enlightenment that they like and accentuate the positives and ignore all the negatives. Then I wonder how much of the current moment is down to a kind of pick and choose history where you don't look at what happened in the French Revolution, for example, and people who call themselves Enlightenment and assume that we're such rational beings and we're going to have a wonderful future and so on. Yet here we are now, because you've repressed maybe elements that were there even within the Enlightenment itself, that you now have to deal with it. It's hitting you dead on, you know what I mean? But I don't know.
I think that's a really important point. There's quite a few points that I wanted to come back on, but I'll address this one. Like, I actually think that's a really important point. And I've actually mentioned it before. I think that one of the flaws of many, you know, people that regard themselves as champions of the Enlightenment is the kind of failure to recognize or realize or come to terms with the way in which the Enlightenment was actually often weaponized during that period in order to justify colonialism. You know, it was this idea of kind of bringing civilization to the savages. And again, so that there was a massive contradiction there. And I think people have been uncomfortable being able to confront that contradiction. But I think that's, one might say that for Christianity or other beliefs, that there's the principles and the ideals versus the reality of human nature, and those things that human beings are, you know, whether that is aspects of our us can be domineering, can be violent and vicious, and I think that these things are ultimately ideals that we can aspire to. I think that is a true criticism in regards to this kind of very rose-tinted view of the way in which the Enlightenment ended up playing out. But again, I think that, again, we have to go back to values, because people often, again, forget, you know, the Haitian Revolution, for example, it was a slave revolt, and they actually justified what they were doing on the grounds that, you know, the French Revolution, you held these ideals of all men are created equal, but you're not keeping them to yourself. Similarly with African Americans, the Constitution talked about all of these positive visionary ideas, and it's been African Americans that have consistently forced America to look itself in the face and hold itself to its own shortcomings. So I think that we have to separate the principles and the ideals versus, you know, necessarily the way in which humans have been flawed in keeping to those things. So I don't necessarily see a contradiction there.
No worries. I think too that Dr. King talked about the American Revolution and the idea of the promissory note that it was yet to be written and so on. So that kind of goes in line with that. Back to America then. What do you think of Joe Biden running for president and his choice of Kamala Harris as the vice president? And what are maybe some of the biggest threats for Christians and liberals alike with their kind of radical politics, or people like AOC coming through and becoming more mainstream?
Yeah, so this is kind of partly what I was saying, about why I didn't necessarily think that the answer was religious, so to speak. I think that we have a complete collapse of politics, a collapse of political authority in society in general. And I think it will take a deep period of reflection, realization, and then reflection to start creating the kinds of not only political language, but meaningful responses to the complete vacuum that we have right now. I mean, Joe Biden, he is, what are his ideas? You know, no one actually knows what is his defining ideas? What is his vision? His only view is that he's not Trump. And I think that particular idea is a complete, will not succeed in my view. I could be wrong, but I think that it fails to meaningfully recognize the reasons why Trump came to be elected, whether or not you agree with his politics or his way of being. I think that his election was a manifestation of a kind of sentiment, and that was to some extent felt in other parts of the Western world, that the kind of political establishment had sold many people down the river and disregarded, you know, Middle America and all of these things. And Joe Biden hasn't really got anything to say to that. Not being Trump isn't a political ideology. It is not a worldview, and it's definitely not going to be able to deal with the kinds of crazy things that are going on in America right now. So I think he's lackluster, and I think it's a sad state of affairs that the best option for a potential different idea of what America could be is, in the eyes of some people, Joe Biden, really. So yeah, again, it's a huge failure of politics, yeah. Massively.
Again, from an Irish perspective, then America seems to have an incredibly good classical education system with a lot of potential, but it seems that it's kind of far removed from urban communities and a lot of African American children who are sort of left to the public schools, which really means government schools. So it's that phrasing again, I think, to make it sound more appealing. Plus, the left obviously controls those state schools, unfortunately, in places like Baltimore. I was wondering, you spend so much time with the Equiano Project, you're trying to educate people, but you're obviously working against a lot, the whole forces of the media and the government and the schools and so on. Do you think that there are some working models for more classical or liberal education, say, in Britain? So I know you had Catherine Burblesing on, and I had her on this podcast as well to talk about her work. Do you have any thoughts about how we might inculcate those ideas into the next generation whenever we are up against so much?
Yeah, I think that's a really good question. And I think it connects to the earlier point that I made about the failure of politics, because, and particularly in regards to the left. So that's why the left essentially moved into the sphere of education and universities, because they didn't necessarily believe that they could win their arguments in the political sphere on their arguments alone. And so that's why we've seen the kind of indoctrination essentially going on in schools by largely kind of lefty teachers and academics and people in the media. And I think that that's problematic. I think that the model would definitely be, you know, a school like Michaela's school. I think it really is. And I think it's a non-selective school. It's a school that, you know, doesn't categorize and regard people solely based over their race. It talks about, you know, which the phrase she uses, you know, working hard and being kind. You know, there's many different thinkers that go there and speak. The kids get to see the potential of what they could be. It cultivates aspiration, and that, you know, regardless of where you are from, you can succeed. And I think that, you know, a lot of people talk about funding. It's always about funding. They need more money. I'm sure that could potentially help, but I think a sense of leadership and authority within a school really does you know, shape the entire ethos and give the culture a real sense of potential. So I definitely think a school like Michaela is the way, and I'm a big supporter of free schools. I think that if you are passionate, if you know your subject, if you really believe in what you're doing, you should be able to be a teacher. You should be able to educate the next generation. And I think that we need schools that are experimenting, that are trying new things and thinking imaginatively, not, you know, complaining all the time. And so yeah, the Michaela school, I think it speaks for itself. They had one of the highest results in the country, and I think it's a real amazing testament to if you have strong values, a strong ethos and strong leadership in the school, then that's a very is a strong recipe for success. But I think more broadly, again, we're massively losing our culture of criticism, our culture of critique. I would really love to see that cultivated much more in schools, you know, encouraging debating, encouraging young people to actually start engaging with some of these really deep ideas that are affecting society and forcing them to, or encouraging them to justify their position and getting into debates. That should be normalized, I think, from very, very early on. In order to, you know, cultivate a sense of active citizenship from a young age.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for that, Inaya. Just to close up then, I wanted to ask you, is there anything else that you're working on now that you still feel the passion to get involved with in the future that you'd like to tell us about?
I think right now, again, I'm very much, this is why I said the thing about transhumanism. I'm very much the kind of person that I think I do think about the future, but I think particularly when it comes to social and political issues, I think it's really important to stay grounded in what's relevant right now. And I think when we keep that kind of specificity, then we're able to very much be active in shaping the way that things go. So freedom of speech and racial politics are definitely something that I'm going to be likely focusing on for the foreseeable future. But on a broader standpoint, just trying to create arguments and share arguments that do enable people to see this kind of spark of divinity within each of us and to not see that our potential is stunted by gender, race, or any of these categories. So yeah, I've got nothing specific else that I am working on, but the Aquano project is definitely something that is the dominant time consumer in my life at the moment.
Well, thank you for taking time out to speak to me, and you know, it's been a pleasure.
Thank you for inviting
me. Bless you. Cheers.